So from a security perspective, and we just did this when I started at DXE, we started our awareness campaign for our security policies all over again. So instead of annual awareness training, we're doing actually knowledge tips all throughout the every month to make sure that people are really doing it. Besides just your phishing campaigns, this is, hey, did you know, right? To remind people, if you're working at the Starbucks, who could be looking over your shoulder and seeing something that they shouldn't? Make sure you're not having that conversation in a Starbucks, that nobody should hear our pricing that they're also able to see over your shoulder, right? So it's things like that. But we absolutely have to put all of those security controls in place that weren't necessarily as important because people were leaving their computers at work, or they weren't taking them home, or they were doing all of their work in the office, so they didn't have to worry about what was going on around them. So, you know, thinking about all of those security pieces, and then security itself, like my cyber team, we have a lot of monitoring going on that of our employees' devices to see where are they going on their laptops, you know, whether it be another site. We've put some rules in place of places you can't go now that you could go before, just because we can't have the eyes and ears in the office that we didn't have before. And with all the new joiners that you have, you know, they're just not used to maybe necessarily working in a office, and they don't know the difference between what is good professional and secure etiquette versus what they used to do in college or wherever they came from, that it was okay.
So you touched on a sensitive topic of monitoring, and particularly with all, and you know, this is going to you too, but we, you know, executives and leaders in the organization sent all their employees overnight because they had to, and that was it. And then over time, thinking about, do they come back? Do they not come back? Where are they? You know, and for some employees, maybe it was not a concern. Some it might have been. But I'd be curious, especially now in this very difficult job market and different expectations of, potential employees, you know, monitoring's a touchy subject, and you know, what are you seeing? How do you deal with it?
Yeah, it is a touchy subject. I think, to your point, the education piece is key. Yeah. Employees don't mind rules. They just want to understand why they exist. They want to be good stewards. They want to do the right thing. So ensuring that when you have a policy, that it's really based, it's rooted in true risk and true risk mitigation, and then ensuring that, you know, you're giving them agency to take steps to kind of do it on their own as much as you can. So kind of like ensuring that there's behavior hygiene so that they feel like they're kind of doing the work instead of just feeling like, you know, as much as possible that this is locked down, I can't do anything. Yeah.
Our sensitivity, I think, in this time has been more about, why do you care where I live now? So I used to live in Manhattan, and during the pandemic, I've relocated, and what are the new expectations of where I'm going to work, and why do you, as my employer, get a say in where I choose to live if we can work so effectively in this virtual way, if I understand the safety and security protocols of being on the road or not being tethered to an office? And for the folks we hired during the pandemic who aren't tethered to a location, I mean, there was a moment during the Great Resignation where we would have taken a candidate on the moon if they had a strong signal, right? I mean, we don't really care where they are as long as they can service the client. But then if you live on the moon, do you have to go into the New York office 2 to 3 times a week? Where's your marketplace? And so we're dealing with a lot of questions right now of, if I live near a market, am I expected to come in? If I don't, who pays for it? Do I pay for it? Do you pay for it? Do I have to be vaccinated? So there's all of this complexity, and you talked about self-agency, and that's really the rub, I think, the autonomy rub of, you value and trust me as an adult, but you're encroaching on my business a little bit if you're starting to weigh in on where I live, how I use my technology, does my compensation change based on the market that I'm in? And I think there are a lot of tender questions coming up in the employee experience right now that we're still answering. Yeah. They're not easy.
In the past, you were an office worker, you got your office set up, and that's what you had. Mm-hmm. Then people go home and they have a different setup, and now do they get both? how do you navigate the budget?
They would sure like that. They would sure like to have an agency-funded home setup with a docking station and multiple monitors. They would like us to say, you don't need a home computer. You may use your work computer for your personal life, just like you spend some of your day at work doing personal things and some of your work time. They expect that level of, trust me to make a good decision so long as I understand the policy. But if you want me to come into the office, I want a seamless experience. I don't want to bring my monitor. I want my monitors waiting for me. I want a headset waiting for me. I want to understand the sanitation protocols and make it easy for me. If you want me to be hybrid, make that really seamless and easy for me.
And then you're doubling the IT budget.
And that's expensive.